Stories Bigger Than Texas, the Alamo podcast. Late November 1835, a Texas Revolution skirmish that history remembers as quite unusual. Today we reveal how the grass fight happened, the impact it had on control of San Antonio, and how it helped bring revolution closer to the Alamo. I'm your host, Emily Baucom. Joining us today is Ernesto Rodriguez, the Alamo Senior Curator, Historian, and Lecturer. Thanks for coming back on the podcast.
It's my pleasure, Emily.
The grass fight takes place here in San Antonio in late November 1835. Remind us, who controls San Antonio at this point in the revolution?
So at this point in the revolution, hostilities have broken out in Gonzales. The Texian army has now arrived in San Antonio. There's been several small battles around the area. And the Mexican army still controls the town and the Alamo itself.
So on November 26, 1835, a scout named Erastus Deef Smith rides into the Texan camp with information. Who is he and what information does he have?
So Erastus Deef Smith was a gentleman that lived in town, really didn't want to take part in the revolution until he was harassed coming home. And as a result, Travis will write a letter to Henry Smith, the governor of Texas at the time, and he says he is the bravest of the brave, basically putting Deef Smith in a position of being an asset to the Texas Revolution, which he will be. Now, prior to November 26, the Mexican army has been under siege. And so when you think about a siege, you know, it's surrounding the area, preventing supplies and goods from coming and going. And the Texan army is trying to do that, right? They're not as successful as other sieges have been, but they're still trying to do their job. But one of the things that happens early in the month is Travis, who is a cavalry officer, he's scouting and he follows this horse herd. And he ends up capturing a large horse herd that the Mexican army had sent out to find fodder and food. And they get captured after a small engagement. And you think about, why are they sending these animals out? There's a reason. And the effect will be on November 26th.
They thought the Mexican army was bringing payroll to San Antonio.
Yes, and that's one of those things that's funny, is that the Mexican army, Colonel Gartachea, had gone off to bring reinforcements. And so he had left for Laredo. They're waiting, and they're waiting, and the Texians are waiting. And so a word comes from Deef Smith. He spotted a large contingency of horses and pack mules coming, and immediately the minds of men start to wonder and say, is it the silver that's here to pay the Mexican soldiers, the payroll? It starts to really push the imagination. It causes for some men to disobey orders.
This is all taking place near Alisan Creek. Where in modern-day San Antonio would that be in relation to the Alamo?
It would be basically directly west of us. So if you're traveling west, you would be going down Guadalupe Street. It would be in the area of the Alisan Apache Courts area.
Modern day, just west of downtown.
Just west of downtown.
So the Texas side is thinking, payday, the Mexican army is coming in with a bunch of silver and we're going to make a fortune. What really happened?
So Burleson, who is now in command of forces because Austin has left and he was elected commander, Edward Burleson, he sends Bowie with a small group of cavalry to go and do recon work, just basically assess the situation. But a lot of the men know that if Bowie is going out, he's going to engage them because that's Bowie's persona. Well, when you're thinking about it being silver and you're told to stay behind, that means you're going to miss out on the cut of whatever's found. And so a group of men decide to march after the cavalry unit, and it's about 100, 140 men that march out after them. So you've got about 180 Texans marching out. They engage the Mexican army, and the Mexican army is reinforced by Cos, who is the commander. General Cos sends troops out to help the group that's now being attacked. And some of the Texians are basically caught in a crossfire in a ditch. They start falling back. Now, rifle fire is a lot more accurate than musket fire, so the muskets aren't as accurate. They're firing cannon shot. Texians are firing rifles. They force them back. And at one point, they're able to capture the pack train because the Mexican army sees that they're not going to be able to keep it. So that when the Mexican army reaches town, they've lost the pack mules. Texans are excited until they go searching through the packs.
And they did not find silver.
No, they did not. They found hay and grass and fodder for the cavalry horses that are inside the Alamo. And so it's a totally different situation. You know, you go from this really exciting prospect of silver to going, this is grass.
And a lot of people died to get this grass.
Yeah, there were many people that died. On the Texan side, there's a number of casualties, and the numbers fluctuate anywhere from 4 to 14. Mexican army, same way, they fluctuate from anywhere from 14 through 60, and a lot of wounded. One of the men that fought in that battle would write, we don't know how many Mexican casualties there were because we let them drag their comrades out afterward because we were not interested in that. They were interested in searching the pack train.
So this was a fog of war situation. A lot of fighting and a lot of death over what ended up not being super valuable.
It wasn't valuable in the sense of
money,
but it was valuable in a different way. And the value came from the fact that the Texians now knew how dire the situation was for the Mexican cavalry. Now, the Texans were suffering themselves. You know, they had been writing letters saying, we need supplies, we need clothes, we need food, we need coffee, we need this, we need that, to the provisional government. The Mexican army is doing the same thing. And the capture of this grass shows that the cavalry is starved. And so the horses are starved. The men probably are too.
So the Texans ended up with the grass as winter is coming.
Yes. So now they have fodder for their animals if they need it. But it's one of those interesting points that, you know, you capture grass. And so they jokingly call it the grass fight. And after the battle, a lot of the guys will be poking fun at those that are wounded. There was one Texan that got hit by a ricochet in the forehead. And he's complaining about a headache. And they're like, well, that's all you got? And so they're joking about this as men do around the fire. And there was one man that disappeared completely. And so they would find him later at Gonzales, and they would say, you know, he got so scared, he ran all the way to the settlements. Whether it was true or not, you know, he did end up at Gonzales later. But it's one of those things that's an interesting fight because the goal was silver and the outcome is grass.
How long did the grass fight last?
So it lasted a couple of hours, possibly, and it's because of the fact that it's a moving battle. It starts with cavalry, and cavalry under Bowie, basically they charge in, and rifles aren't as easy to wield as a carbine, right? It's a shorter weapon. And the Mexican army has lances, so you've got Texans charging in with basically rifles and Bowie knives and big knives and swords, and then you've got the Mexican cavalry charging with lances and swords, and they would like pass each other and smack each other and then run back. It just so happens that that group of men that decided to go on their own on foot arrive on the scene, and they start firing, but they also get themselves into a crossfire problem. They crawl in, go down into a ditch, and there's Mexican artillery and cavalry on one side, and there's Mexican infantry on the other, because the Morelos battalion is sent out from the Alamo to fill in the reserves, and they're able to get out because of rifle fire pushing back the Mexican army. There's an account from one of the Texans that states that when they were firing against the Mexican army, the Morelos battalion starts marching towards them very calmly. Well, yeah, they're a professional standing army. These are men that are battle-hardened troops. They withstand about 3 to 4 rounds of canister against the Texans. And then finally, the Texans are able to push back the Mexican army far enough that they just withdraw into the town. But it's one of those battles that's really interesting because they go into a ditch and almost get killed by crossfire because of the haze and the smoke, and they don't know where men are because it's so smoky, and, you know, it's chaotic. But it's also one of those things that you're like, we're going to get rich.
Hindsight's always 20/20. Another Texas historian has said, hundreds of animals carrying silver, it just doesn't compute.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it doesn't. You know, it doesn't make sense. But when you're standing there after being basically bored for a while, you're looking around and they come up with this word. All it takes is one guy to have that pop into his head and he tells another, and it's like playing telephone. And before you know it, everybody's up in a frenzy. And that's why many disobey and actually charge out with Bowie on foot, because they want their piece of the pie. In this case, they got their piece of the grass.
The official Texas Historical Commission historical marker for the grass fight calls it, quote, one of the least decisive but certainly most unusual battles of the Texas War for Independence. What's your reaction to that?
It truly is not what the marker says, because one, they find out that the dire situation inside the walls of the Alamo. And then two, it's a morale booster for the men that were already leaving the army. They don't want to be here. So you think about it. From the 26th to the 5th, there's a fluctuation because December 5th is when the Battle of Bear starts. So men have been leaving, and now they have this victory. So there's a morale boost, and there's a situation now where you're like, maybe we can do something about it.
So you think the historical marker is incorrect by saying least decisive because it did propel morale. But you've got to agree with most unusual.
No, it is. It is the most unusual because, you know, what you end up with is funny. But at the same time, morale is boosted, and morale is an important thing in this type of situation.
What impact did the grass fight have on control of San Antonio?
The grass fight leads to the Battle of Bear, and that battle will be the decisive battle that will leave the Alamo in the hands of the Texans in December. So it actually does build up to it because they go from Gonzales to a siege to the Battle of Concepcion to the capture of the horses to the grass fight. So that span in early November to late November, there's a lot of movement of people and going like, well, we can't feed our own horses. So they're sending them home. With the grass fight, now you have food for your horses. You have this boost of morale. You have this idea that maybe we can do something.
It keeps the Texans going just a little bit longer.
Yes, it does. It's that basically it lights that match one more time.
And then in the aftermath, what is Travis doing?
Travis is actually riding around doing recon work. He's doing what he's been told to do, to keep patrolling and do, you know, scouting. And so he's away at this point. But he's had a really important role with the capture of over 300 horses that are then marched to Gonzales. So the cavalry is now being resupplied. The grass fight is basically the culmination of a siege of the town of Bear. And with this battle that may be small when you think about what is captured, it's actually really important because it propels the Texian forces into action in December, and it propels them to capture the town and then gain control of the Alamo itself.
Ernesto Rodriguez, thank you so much for joining us.
It's always a pleasure, Emily.
Be sure to check out the podcast notes. We've linked to more information on the grass fight, including the historical marker we referenced earlier in the conversation. The Alamo Podcast will be taking a break next week as we celebrate Thanksgiving here in the United States. We'll see you right back here in December. You've been listening to Stories Bigger Than Texas, the Alamo Podcast.